Hello, good morning students. Welcome to virtual classes. In this session, we will discuss about a novel which is prescribed for you. That is Jonathan Livingston Seagull, a story written by Richard Bach. And you will have a nearly 24 to 25 marks questions from this novel in your semester examination. And this novel was very popular and many copies were sold between 1970 to 1972. So which made Richard Bach a millionaire through this novel. And this is the story of a seagull. Its name is Jonathan Livingston Seagull, who lives with other flock of seagulls but who looks at life very differently from others. Other seagulls does not give importance to flying and flight in general. They thought flying is an activity just to find food and to survive. But Jonathan Livingston Seagull gives so much importance to flight and flying that he wants to explore it. He wants to learn more about it. He sees the flying as an art, a process, a gift which we must explore it and try to be better at it. He takes risks. He learns to fly up above the sky. He learns different techniques of flying. He fails in the beginning but never gives up. Finally, he achieves a great success. And there can be many lessons which we can draw from this novel. We must know life is nothing short of a miracle. It's a gift. It's an art. It's a process. We must explore it. We must achieve a great things in life by taking risk. But instead, what do? We give importance to food, to pleasure, entertainment, and to all those materialistic, futile things. We trap ourselves in our comfort zones. We can apply this novel situation to any of the things in our life, like learning a foreign language, starting a business, switching to a new job, and doing a dream project. We become so much comfortable with what we have. We do not discover a new things. We do not take risks. We do not come out of our comfort zones. We don't cross our boundaries. So do you think we are just born to live, survive and fight? No. So there are many things which we need to explore. So that lesson we can learn from this novel. Now let us see an actual text about this. Since it is a novel, it's not possible to explain you by reading line by line like an English lesson, but you have to read and understand. I will just revise it a main important things. So this novel contains four parts. In the part one, in the first paragraph, you can see that it was a morning. And again, you can see the sun rays sparkled across the gentle sea, and there was a fishing boat which chummed the water, which hit the water, and you can see a breakfast flock flashed through the air, and a crowd of thousands of seagulls came to get and fight for the bits of food. It was another busy day, beginning like any other normal day. So this is quite common. The thousands of seagulls are fighting for the bits of a food, so which is a mile away from the shore, but way off alone, but a quite a distance away, alone out by himself beyond the boat and the shore. There was a special seagull that is Jonathan Livingston Seagull. It was not fighting for the food, it was practicing flying. It was 100 feet in the sky. He lowered his webbed feet. You can see that for a Jonathan Livingston Seagull, it's quite different from other seagulls. Whereas other seagulls fight for a food, this seagull is practicing how to fly with the different techniques. So, and when it tries, so it you can see a seagull. So this feathers ruffled. It stalled. It that means this in the air it stopped and it could not get a balance and it fell. And as we know that a seagulls, they never falter. Falter means they never lose the strength, energy. They never stop. So that is to stop in the air for them, it's like a disgrace or disrespect. But for a Jonathan Livingston Seagull, it was not ashamed. So it was to learn. Obviously, when we are learning a new things, we fail, we fall down many times. But still, we again get back and practice. Definitely, one day, we learn the art. Similarly, Seagull is doing it. And you can also see that. And most girls, they are not bothered to learn more than the simplest facts of a flight. So that is how to go to the shore and how to get a foot and back. So for them, it's not important that learn flying. So for them, they don't bother to learn more of flying. They're just a simplest fact. So how to get a foot, how to go to a shore and how to get back. So most girls, it's not flying that is important. For other girls, it's the most important is eating, and surviving is important for other girls. For obviously for this girl, that is Jonathan girl, Jonathan Livingston, it is not eating that is more important. The flight is more important. So it loves to fly more than anything else. But this kind of a thinking, it will not make him a popular among other girls. But still, so Jonathan Livingston, it spent the whole day all alone trying to fly and achieve a new heights in flying. Even their parents, Jonathan Livingston's parents, they were not happy, they were dismayed. In the sense, they were disappointed. They tried to advise. You can see Jonathan Livingston's mother asked, why it is so hard to be like the rest of the flocks? Why, Jonathan? Why can't you be just like other flocks? Why do you want to be different? Why do you want to try a flying? Why can't you leave that flying to a birds like pelicans and all heterosaurs? Again, these are the sea birds with a heavy weight. So, but for Livingston, it wanted to know. So, what it can do in the air? So that's what he wanted to know. And again, Jonathan Livingston's father, warned him, winter is approaching and boats also will be very few and the surface fish also will be swimming very deep and getting a food for a seagull is very difficult and he must concentrate on getting a food and surviving, not that flying. It tried to warn. So Jonathan Livingston nodded obediently. For the next few days, it tried to behave like other girls, but it was very hard for him. There is some kind of a burning desire to achieve something different, which is greater than what other girls have not achieved for him. It could not control himself, and again, far from the 1,000 feet, again it started practicing. In just 6 seconds, he was moving 70 miles per hour. And obviously, it was the greatest speed. and again climbing it to 1,000 feet full power straight. It is practicing again and again, but when it climbs to 1,000 feet, he could lose a control. He could not fly. He could stop, and obviously he could fall down, and he has to practice more and more. 10 times he has practiced, and again he could not do it. For some time he felt that it was not possible for a bird like a seagull to fly, and again he says that. So his father was right what he said, and obviously that bird was not meant for flying high. So obviously for some time it thought that it's not possible. So if I were meant to learn so much about flying, I would have charts for bones. If I were meant to fly speed, I would have falcons shot. Now it is trying to convince it's not possible to fly very high. So as my father was right, I must forget this foolishness and I must fly home to the flock and be happy with what I am. And I am not born to fly very high, so my capabilities are very limited. It thought for a few days, but he could not be happy with what he thought it. And again he thought, and again and again and again he gained some kind of a thought came to his mind, just like a light in a moon. And again he said that, "Get down, seagull, never fly in the dark. If you were meant, you can see." And here again he thought that he can. So then he got a technique. "If I want to fly high, I should have a short wings." So that is the answer, is what a fool I have been. All I need is a tiny little wing. All I need is to fold most of my wings and fly on just the tips alone, short wings. Now it got the technique how it can balance when it goes up. Again he climbed 2000 feet above the Black Sea and tried again. Now you can see that 70 miles per hour it could fly. Again 90 miles per hour, 120 miles per hour, and faster still. Now by this time it has achieved the greatest speed that no other gull has ever dared to fly so high. Again closed his eyes, he slits again 140 miles per hour and under control. "If I dive from 5000 feet instead of 2000, I wonder how fast." Again he tried more and more. After achieving one step, it tried to achieve the next step. One has touched the excellence in his learning, has no need of this kind of promise. So again he was alive. He thought that. Again he practiced again and again. He was alive, trembling ever so slightly with delight. Now he is happy he could achieve it. From 5000 feet, the fishing boat were just like a specks, in the sense a dots, and they were floating on a blue water. Now a breakfast flock was a faint cloud of a dust. Breakfast flock were just appearing like a dust. He was above the 5000 feet from the seashore and flying. So he was very excited. He could control the wind. When it was flying, it was beating like a wall against which he was flying. Now straight down, you can see that he could not. He began his pull out 1000 feet wing tips. He couldn't stop. He did not know it. So it happened that, so now it is quite happy that it could achieve great things. It happened that morning, then just after sunrise, that Jonathan Livingston seagull fired directly through the center of the breakfast flock, ticking off 212 miles per hour. So eyes closed in a great roaring, and all these days it was practicing up above the sky. And one day morning when it was flying, which was just passed through the center of a breakfast flock. In the sense, thousands of seagulls, they were catching a fish for a breakfast, and it was moving 212 miles per hour. It was just like a breakthrough. The gull of a fortune smiled upon him this once, and no one killed. By the time he had pulled his beak straight up into the sky, he was still scorching alone at 160 miles per hour. When he had slowed to 20 and stretched his wings again at last, the boat was a crumb on the sea, 4,000 feet below. He thought it was a shrimp. Terminal velocity, a seagull at breakthrough. The greatest single moment in the history of flock. And in that moment, a new age opened for a Jonathan gull. That is flying out to his lonely practice area, folding his wings for a dive from 8,000 feet. He set himself at once to discover how to turn. Now a Jonathan Livingston, it was practicing, and again, now it is from 8,000 feet high, so it is practicing how fast it could fly. Now you can see 4,000 feet below, so 24,000, and it was 214 miles per hour speed. And it was just like a record breakthrough. So it was very happy for what it has achieved. It was something that it has made history in the life of our seagulls. And it had opened a new age for the seagulls, that is in the flying. So a single wingtip, so that it was practicing the whole day. When Jonathan Seagull returned back his home, so it was joined the flock on the beach. It was full night. He was dizzy. It was almost sleepy. He was terribly tired practicing. Yet he was very happy that he could learn. He could achieve great things in flying. When other flock hear of the achievement that Jonathan Livingston has made, that is breakthrough, he thought that they will all become wild with joy. So how much more now he is to living, instead of just we were hanging back and forth to fishing boats. Now there is a reason for life. We can lift ourselves out of ignorance. We can find ourselves as the creatures of excellence and intelligence and skill. And we can be free. We can learn. The years ahead hummed, glowed with a promise. The gulls were flocked into the council. Now it was very happy that it could achieve something great. So when Jonathan returned, so the flocks were gathered, the council gathered at when he landed, and apparently had been so flocked for some time. They were in fact waiting, all the seagulls together, they were waiting for the arrival of the Jonathan Swift. Jonathan Livingston Seagull, stand to the center. The elder's words sounded in a voice of highest ceremony. When it has landed, there were all the thousands of the flock gathered together, and ahead of this folk council, they spoke in a ceremonious way that Jonathan Livingston Seagull, you stand at the center. Stand to center meant only for a great shame or a great honor. Generally, when a seagull's flock, they ask them to stand at the center. Only when a person achieves great things to honor him, or when he does a big mistake, obviously to punish him. Now, stand at the center meant only for a great shame or great honor. So now Jonathan thought that definitely they wanted to honor him for a great things he has achieved it. So he thought that, and he thought a breakthrough, breakfast flock this morning. They saw the breakthrough, but I want no honors. I have no wish to be a leader. I want only to share what I have found, to show those horizons out ahead for us all. He stepped forward. So Jonathan Livingston, when an elder of the seagull asked him to come and stand in the center, he thought that he has been asked to come to the center in order to honor him. So they thought that these folk at the breakfast, so they must have informed my breakthrough, so they must have been calling for honoring me. I don't want any kind of a honor. I just wanted to share how I felt the things when I explored the new things. But the thing was different. Jonathan Livingston Seagull, said the elder, stand to the center for a shame in the sight of your fellow gulls. Okay, for his reckless irresponsibility and violating the dignity of the tradition of the gull family. But an elder seagull said, you have to stand at the center just for a shame, because you were so irresponsible. You have broken or violated the dignity, the respect and the tradition of the girl's family. For that you have to be shamed. Now when her seagull heard this, so it felt like it has been hit with a big board. And to be sentenced for a shame meant that he would be cast out of a girl's society. He would be banished to a solitary life on a cliff, in the sense, so that is standing for a shame in the sense, so he will be banished. That is, he would be banished from the girl's family, and he had to live a solitary, lonely life. So at the top of the mountain, then he will understand. One day, Jonathan Livingston Seagull, you will learn. So what the punishment that you will have to face for being an irresponsible. Life is not possible to be known. It is an unknown and unknowable. So we are born only to eat, to stay alive as long as we can. Then a seagulls never speak back to the council flock. But this Jonathan so spoke, his voice raised, irresponsibility? My brothers, he cried, who is more responsible than a girl who finds and follows a meaning, a higher purpose for a life? For 1,000 years we have been scrabbled after a fish heads, but now we have a reason to live, to learn, to discover, to be free. Give me a chance. Let me show you what I have found. Now he said, do you think will there be any person more responsible than who finds the new things, who explores the new things, who shows the way for a people to have a better things in a life? Now, so we from a thousands of years we had been hanging behind a fish heads. Now, okay, I have found out, I have learned new things. Give me a chance to show what I have been found. But the flock might as well have been stone. The brotherhood is broken. The girls, they said, okay, our brotherhood is broken. They said in a particular voice, and they turned. They did not give a chance for a Jonathan to speak. Now a Jonathan Livingston has been banished, and he is living a solitary life in a far off the top of the mountain. So now he is quite sad. His sorrow is not that he is lonely, but his sorrow was, so the girls, they refuse to believe the great heights that they have, that he has achieved when he was practicing. But he continued to practice more and more. So even though he has been banished from the flock, but he was very happy. He was practicing, and one day, obviously, so there were other two seagulls who came to him, and they spoke that they were their brothers, and they appeared to be the gulls so who have learnt just like great things like Jonathan. They said, "So come, so we are your brothers, come, we will go to our home." Further, they said, "I have no home, I have been banned, or I'm an outcast from the flock. I have no flock, I have none. I'm an outcast, and we fly now at the peak of the great mountain wind. Beyond a few hundred feet, I can lift this old body no higher." "But you can," they said, we are your brothers, but you can, Jonathan, for you have learned. One school is finished, and the time has come for another to begin. When it was practicing all alone in the fore of the cliffs, two other gulls came and spoke to him in a friendly voice, and they said that they were their brothers. And even these gulls must have been an outcast one day from the seagull's family for so exploring the new things. So now they said, "So far beyond this mountain, great mountain wind, we have our home. And one school of learning is finished, and now the time has come to begin another." So as it had shined across him, all his life, so understanding lighted that moment. So they were right, he could fly higher, and it was time to go home. He gave one last look across the sky. And it was magnificent silver land where he had learned so much. "Now," he said, "I'm ready," he said at last. And Jonathan Livingston Seagull rose with the two star bright gulls to disappear into the perfect dark sky. So this ends the part one of the novel, and the part two will continue in the next session. Thank you. You go through the part one thoroughly for a better understanding. I will give you questions, possible questions, 2 marks as well as 4 marks, which you will get in this part. Thank you.